Welcome to Paul or Nothing, the place to get all of your Paul, all of the time. Join me, your host, Sam Wiles, as we discover the history, the music, and the man behind it all, Paul McCartney. To get in contact with the show, email us at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com.
Hello, hello, hello! Is it me you're looking for? And welcome to another episode of Paul or Nothing. This is widescreen podcasting and the place to get all of your Paul, all of the time. Of course, I am your host, Sam Wiles. Thank you all for listening. I hope you're all well, safe, and sound. So, as you probably know, last episode was when we spoke to Denny motherfucking Seiwell. And being the Uber Wings slash early Paul fan that I am, I probably spent more time talking about that phase of his life more than his publicist would have preferred. So to make up for that somewhat, we're going to follow up with a conversation with the head producer and mastermind of the album that we did indeed touch on somewhat last episode. If you don't remember, the album is called Ram On, the 50th anniversary tribute to Paul and Linda McCartney's Ram, which is out on May 14th, 2021. And very shortly, we're going to be speaking with prolific producer Fernando Perdomo about its production, its inspiration, and, you know, how it all came together. Like I mentioned in my last episode, I didn't actually make contact with Fernando until I'd already booked Denny solo, and if I'd have known I could have chatted to both of them at the same time, I guess I probably would have gone down that route. Though, in retrospect, having Denny on solo did mean that I could have a one-on-one with him. It was very special, and I could indeed indulge in some more Wings and early solo Paul stuff. Plus, as you can see from today's episode, my chat with Fernando is also really, really long and, hopefully, as you'll see by the end, really in-depth. So I'm glad that I've ended up getting two episodes out of this, not only because they're two separate episodes and I'm a shameless capitalist who wants to stretch out as much content as he can, but also because I'm just glad that I got to speak to each of these guys independently. No one had to talk over each other and everyone got to have their full say on this project. And there may be some crossover, but also you might get a new perspective on some things we touched on last time as well. Obviously, if you haven't listened to my episode with Denny Seiwell, what are you doing here? Go back and listen to that first. We'll be waiting for you. Of course, Fernando was a delight to talk to, and he roundly displayed that not only is he an incredibly talented musician and supremely knowledgeable chap in terms of the world of music, but he's also just a really nice person, a very giving person, and this interview has everything that was missing from the last episode, but so much more. Also, as someone who is far too self-conscious about whether they speak too much on this show and interrupt people too frequently, Fernando is the perfect guest for, as you are about to hear, you know, you give him the most minute little nugget of a question to go off and he will talk for 10, 15 minutes straight. I probably admire that so much because it reminds me a little bit of myself, but yeah, since the lion's share of editing goes into all of my stuttering and breathing and ums and ahs, this episode didn't take all that long to put together. So that's also why it's out a little bit early as well. I think I have also fixed the audio here with this opening segment here and now. Got the mic back up and running. The audio may be a bit choppy in the interview itself, though. Again, it's Zoom. It was on Fernando's phone and I was having certain issues at the time. Please forgive me. Again, trying to keep the intro short here for you today, folks. But before we can begin our chat with Fernando, we do have to crack on with the admin as we do our
housekeeping.
So, what do we have in terms of news today? Well, true to form, I thought I wasn't going to have anything to put here at all. And then just as I was compiling my last little bit of prep, boom, ClashMusic.com went ahead and released their bloody review of Threemagined, or as they're calling it here, the far clunkier McCartney 3 Reimagined. Anyway, I'm not going to spoil the whole thing. You can check out the website itself in terms of specific song reviews. Though I will say I was glad to see that St. Vincent got one of the two big shout-outs. Can't wait to hear that track. But I'll just read out a quick snippet now that should give you a clue as to their general thoughts on the album. It reads, "Pleasingly diverse, it finds Sir Paul handing over the tapes to some truly incredible artists. Indeed, it's probably time to chalk curatorial abilities onto the lengthy things the Beatle icon excels at. Remixes are often, truth to be told, an absolute chore. A hangover from the 90s era of 17 quid compact discs. This reimagining, however, serves the noble dual task. It illustrates Paul McCartney's continued creative relevance to artists a third of his age, whilst also underlining the craftsmanship that went into last year's McCartney 3. Not an essential listen, perhaps, but one that will fascinate and intrigue fans. Wow, that is quite interesting indeed, isn't it, folks? Not an essential listen, you just heard it there. However, clashmusic.com is not a Paul McCartney site. I'm sure if it was on, say, our blog and I was doing a review that way, which I probably should actually, you could imagine the review would be a little bit more positive. Obviously, we are fans. You're listening to this podcast right now, so it might immediately, automatically be a bit more essential, quote unquote. However, if we are only going to grade this within the spectrum of McCartney's work, obviously there are going to be songs that are less valuable, more valuable, must purchases, albums you don't need to worry about at all, and maybe this will be on the lower end. We are going to find out very soon. At the time of recording, it's coming out in 2 days, and I will be recording a review with a friend of the show very shortly after. Keep your eyes peeled for that one. But yeah, that's really it in terms of the news, apart from me wanting to point out the fact that clashmusic.com misspelled the word reimagining in their review for McCartney 3 Reimagined, as they called it. Maybe if they just called it 3imagined, they would have spelled it correctly, but who knows. Anyway, pressing on to the plugs now. To get in contact with the show, please email us at paulmccartneypod@gmail.com. I always want to hear your Paul McCartney stories, your trivia, your factoids. Have you ever met the man? Do you know someone who knows someone? Have you seen him live? Have you been to any notable or specific gigs? Is there one of my reviews you want to take me up on? Is there an album in the future you want to talk to me about? Maybe I got a fact wrong, or maybe you just want to say hi. Please, like I say, get in contact with the show. I love reading out your emails here. That's paulmccartneypod@gmail.com. Fortunately, for those of you out there who like a short housekeeping segment, we don't have any emails to read out today. Pressing on. Follow us on our Twitter, which is @McCartneyPod, for daily updates. You know, it's the best way to basically keep up to date with the show and all of my little ramblings. Follow us on the socials. Follow us on Instagram, YouTube, and Facebook, simply by typing in Paul or Nothing or Paul McCartney Podcast. Like I say, on the YouTube page, there is always new video highlights that I'm putting out now for each episode that I do via Zoom. So if you aren't a part of the Patreon page, the best way to catch certain episodes early or highlight some episodes early is to make sure you are following us on our YouTube. But yeah, for Facebook and Instagram, also Paul or Nothing or Paul McCartney Podcast. If you want to help out the show right now in a way that takes only a few seconds, please consider leaving us a review on whatever platform you are using. If it's on YouTube, consider giving us the old thumbs up. And hey, if you want to write a comment, if you want to say something really nice, we'd always appreciate that as well. Now, if you want to help out the show directly, finally, I must talk to you about our Patreon page. Of course, Patreon is the place where you, the public, can support independent content creators such as myself. And if you want to help see the show grow, if you want to help keep the lights running, if you want to help me get new equipment, new products to review, that kind of thing, hey, maybe you just want me to have less time at work and more time working on the podcast, then yeah, Patreon is the way to do it. Becoming a member gets you some fantastic benefits, such as early access to episodes. Episodes are fully posted a couple of days early. You also get access to full scripts and research that I do for the podcasts, as well as exclusive video content. So yeah, I'm doing a lot of stuff on Zoom now. And not only can you get full episodes a couple of days early, but I'll basically take the Zoom footage and just put that straight on the Patreon. So in a lot of cases, with episodes that won't be coming out for weeks now, you will be able to watch the full video stream of them that will never be available on YouTube on the Patreon right now. So there is a lot of benefits to joining it, of course. There are also some secret benefits that I like to add that I don't talk about here on the show. So please, if you can afford it, if you are financially stable during these uncertain times, please consider throwing a couple of dollars at my face every month. Like they say, it's a cup of coffee or a pint, something like that. I'm sure many of you would love to buy me a pint, right? Come on. I also would like to welcome the latest kind-hearted soul, Motti Riber. Motti, thank you so much for helping to continue the momentum of our little community. It really just warmed the cockles of my heart. I'm becoming increasingly proud of all the great stuff that we're putting on the Patreon page now, and there's loads more coming on the way, so please enjoy it, and I'm grateful that you think that that is worth it. It is all appreciated. It really is. Thank you to everyone else who is already a part of the Patreon family. Christian Perry, Richard Driver, Chris Atkinson, Richard Binnington, Mr. B, Teresa Brader, Stephanie Miller, Louis DiLeonardo, Cheryl McCoy, Katrina S, Sam Hode, Anastasia L, Robert Carabelli, Warren Butson, and my man, Matt Phillips. Right, folks, that is everything for the plugs now. I've got nothing special or funny to say. I'm sure for many of you out there, you'd probably argue that I never have anything funny to say. But yeah, let's just jump right into my interview with the producer of Ram On, the 50th anniversary tribute to Paul and Linda McCartney's Ram. This is me and Fernando Perdomo. Take it away, me. One, two, three, go. And now, everyone, it's time for me to bring on my next guest, dubbed by the LA Weekly as the millennial answer to Todd Rundgren. He is a professional session musician, played on three number one albums, and was also part of the excellent Echo in the Canyon band. Go and check out that soundtrack if you haven't already, folks. He's an incredibly prolific producer with a bafflingly long credits list, so I'm not even going to attempt to go into it. You know, he kind of makes King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard blush. You know, he's got that many credits. On top of that, he's co-produced a remake of a tribute of my favorite album of all time. And I'm very fortunate to talk to him today. Everyone, please welcome Fernando Perdomo. Fernando, how's it going, my friend?
Hello, everybody. I'm excited, you know, that there's so much passionate fandom for Ram and for what was considered for a long time kind of like a taboo subject, you know, with the Beatles being so important to everyone. And then a lot of times when I was growing up, a huge McCartney and Wings fan, it was like a footnote. It was like the old joke, you know, like, oh, he had a band before Wings. It was kind of like, you know, oh, okay. But it started with the Beatles with me when I was about 6 years old. And by the time I was eight, I had graduated to McCartney and Wings, and it almost eclipsed the Beatles to me. I've always been attracted to 70s music, 70s production, 70s recordings. And to me, McCartney 70 to 80, and actually, no, 70 on, but like, you know, especially 70 to 80 is really fascinating because I feel like it was the best recorded era of McCartney. I feel like fidelity-wise, also the musicians that were involved, the studios, the equipment. I just am in love with those recordings. And as a kid who was learning how to play guitar and learning how to play multiple instruments and becoming fascinated with the production element, listening on my Walkman to Ram, Venus and Mars, Speed of Sound, Wildlife, Red Rose Speedway, all the way up to Back to the Egg, I remember going, wow, this is what I want my music to sound like. And in many ways, if you listen to stuff that I've produced, it is so influenced by 70s production. And I feel like the pinnacle of that is a lot of these great McCartney Wings records. And there's so much to listen to, just starting with the songwriting. I mean, it's just next level. But Paul's bass playing really became something spectacular when he switched to the Rickenbacker and he went to full Wings mode. And there's just so many incredible moments just on bass alone. And he surrounded himself with such inspiring musicians from the Ram Band to the First Wings to the Wings Over America lineup, which I cherish as well, all the way to the Back to the Egg Band, which really... it's a shame that the Back to the Egg Band only got to do one record and was kind of extinguished, you know, in a puff of pot smoke in 1980 before they could have gone on to do something as spectacular as Tug of War. And I always imagine what Tug of War would have sounded like if it was the true follow-up to Back to the Egg. A combination of McCartney 2 and Tug of War done by that Steve Holly, Lawrence Juber, you know, incarnation of Wings would have been really interesting, even though I love Tug of War. And there's some of my favorite McCartney stuff on that record. Some of the session musicians that were included were kind of pasteurized it a little bit, I feel. Like, there's even songs where Paul's not even playing bass, where he's got Stanley Clark, who's fantastic. But, you know, there's just something to that organic sound of musicians playing in a room together, which is something that really started with Ram, with Paul, Denny, Dave Spinoza, or Paul, Denny, Hugh McCracken in the room working these songs out. And one of the coolest things about working with Denny is that he's got the best stories. And he's told us, you know, all the stories about all the sessions for Ram and how these songs were put together in the studio, and how something that I never knew, because all our lives we've heard about Paul being kind of like a dominator in the studio, you know, always telling George what to do, telling John what to do, telling Ringo what to do. And, you know, I'll play whatever you want me to play, or I won't play anything at all. You know, you always hear about that. And one of the things that was fascinating to me was when Denny told me that not once during the sessions for Ram did Paul get behind his drum set and say, play like this. It was everything that you hear in Ram, Wings Over America, Wings Wildlife, and Red Rose Speedway. That's Denny coming up with his own drum parts. And he says only one time.
Yeah, possibly Band on the Run as well. That's Denny.
Yeah, exactly. Because there's Band on the Run. He says that he wishes that they would find the rehearsal tapes of them rehearsing in Scotland for Band on the Run. And we could get a glimpse of what that album could have sounded like with Denny and Henry, which, as you know, that record song-wise is pretty hard to beat. But to me, it always sounded a little more like a demo because of the state of the studio in Lagos and some of the sounds. Mm. I always felt like that album had a crappy drum sound, you know, and just kind of flat, you know, the drums kind of sound like cardboard boxes on that. And I remember being underwhelmed by that record because I first heard Band on the Run, Jet on Wings Over America. Mm. And then I heard Band on the Run, and it kind of left me a little flat because it didn't have the excitement of Joe English's drumming and Jimmy McCulloch's guitar playing on the live stuff. You know, it just didn't have the same balls to me. But it's an incredible record. I mean, there's some incredible moments on Band on the Run, especially 1985. That one kills me. And No Words, the guitars on No Words is just amazing. But I always felt like the drumming, as much as I love Paul, it's not necessarily his drumming. It's the drum sound on Band on the Run that kind of bothers me. And a lot of it was because they didn't have any microphones. From what I understand, when they went to Lagos, they had one good mic and everything else was crappy, you know, $50 microphones. And you could tell, you know, so it's all good.
So as an American producer, perhaps you can give me some insight then into the fact that Ram is the American solo McCartney album as well. It was produced in CBS and A&R recording studios in New York. Are they as famous as like Abbey Road and Hogs Hill Mill over here?
Okay. Here is the interesting thing about A&R to me. I'm all over the place when it comes to my fandom. And one of the artists that I absolutely adore, which funny enough has a big Denny Seiwell connection, is Billy Joel.
Right.
And the album 52nd Street refers to the studio where 52nd Street was recorded, which was A&R Studios.
Right.
So Ram, The Stranger, 52nd Street, Glass Houses, all those albums were done in the same studio. Another set of albums that was done at A&R, Laura Nero, Blood, Sweat, and Tears. Right. A famous thing that happened at A&R that no one ever talks about, because everybody thinks this was recorded at the Troubadour, was the classic Elton John live album, 11-17-70. Mm. That was actually recorded in A&R Studios, even though the cover photo was taken at the Troubadour.
Oh.
So that was actually recorded in a recording studio in front of an audience.
Oh, so but, it's what, kind of like a Nighthawks at the Diner kind of thing with Tom Waits?
A little
right.
bit.
Oh, okay.
A little bit. It's recorded professionally in a recording studio in front of an audience. So when people listen to that record and they close their eyes, they imagine, you know, Elton John, Dee Murray, and Nigel Olsen playing at the Troubadour. Really, it's recorded in a studio.
Could you imagine if someone said, oh, by the way, the crowd chatter at the end of Get Back, that was just fake and in studio. That's not real. Sorry.
Well, you know what's funny is that I just found out a really interesting fact. I'm a huge Blood, Sweat, and Tears fan, and I recently have been binging some interesting videos, and I found one with Steve Katz, who was their guitar player, who went on to produce Lou Reed. And he's talking about how Rock and Roll Animal, his classic live album with Sweet Jane and everything, how one of the microphones in the audience recording didn't work. So they only had a mono audience and they needed a stereo audience recording. So they pulled audience recording from a John Denver concert.
Oh, wow.
And he says he never told Lou Reed because he says it would have killed him. And he says, I wonder if someone told him and then he died. Because, you know, Lou Reed would probably have hated the fact that his audience recording was, you know, from John Denver. But, you know, look, I love Wings Over America, but it's well known that that album was sweetened very much in the studio.
Yeah.
Especially when you hear, like, for example, the Australia performance that's on YouTube.
Yes.
With the same band.
Fantastic, yeah.
And they were, you know, look, Wings Mark One was very loose.
Yeah.
You know, Denny was tight, but he will tell you, he'll be the first to tell you that, you know, Henry and Denny Lane had issues. They were not studio musicians. They were live musicians. Mm-hmm. And their general approach to tuning guitars, to playing the same parts every time, that was actually what I heard was the main issue with Henry, is that he would never play the same solo twice.
Too jazzy, yeah.
Which, you know, it's kind of tough when you're playing McCartney, because I recently did a deep dive into, actually, I want to put this together. I want to put together a supercut of Maybe I'm Amazed, all the different guitar players and their different approaches to.
Yeah.
Because there's the original McCartney, which is kind of twangy, because for McCartney 1, I don't think he had any type of distortion pedal. I think that's just like a Fender Deluxe amp cranked, and it's not necessarily distorted. So it's like his original approach was very kind of twangy. And then Henry McCulloch, he had a very interesting way of playing it, a little sloppy. Mm-hmm. And then Jimmy, oh my God, Jimmy was... People recently, there was a thread on Facebook about songs that really came to life live. And that there's something to that Wings Over America version of Maybe I'm Amazed that just rises to the top. There's that ending, mm-hmm. Jimmy's tone, that feedback that he gets halfway through the solo. It's you know, I do a lot of archaeology. And when I heard Slash for the first time, I heard Jimmy.
Right.
And when they did Live and Let Die, I was like, oh, it all makes sense now. Because I could totally hear young Sal, whatever his name is, Sal Goodstein or whatever, listening to Wings Over America and going, that's a tone. Because I always felt like Jimmy McCulloch's guitar tone and Slash's guitar tone is very similar. Very mid-range, very Gibson, very, very Gibson through a Marshall type sound. And definitely. And then I heard like Lawrence Juber's rendition, which had a lot of effects on it, but very, very Jimmy actually. And then, you know, Robbie McIntosh. I got to see Robbie McIntosh. Now, the first time I'm 40 years old, so I missed the Flowers in the Dirt tour because I was too young. But the first McCartney show I ever saw was Off the Ground tour. The what was it called?
Back in the World, was it?
Back in the U.S. It's not Back in the U.S. It was called the Something USA Tour, and it was amazing, and it was incredible, and I loved Robbie. I am a diehard Biker Like an Icon fan.
Oh.
And I you know, it's like my entire career, I've been a person that I love the underdog. And when I saw people saying that's the worst McCartney song and blah, 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 I love passionately defending Biker Like an Icon.
Yeah, Mary Had a Little Lamb, same
thing. Yeah, exactly. La, la. A lot of the Press to Play album, you know, Give Ireland Back to the Irish, you know. A lot of the McCartney stuff that gets, you know, shat on, I absolutely love. I love Memory Almost Full. That record blows me away. That's my favorite McCartney record of the last... Okay, so I would put that one up against Flowers in the Dirt as the best of the last 20 years to me.
Wow.
In my personal opinion. And I love Chaos and Creation. There's a lot of new that I love. I loved a lot of Egypt Station. I have a funny story about Egypt Station. I met Greg Kirsten.
Ooh.
Because he did a show with Bird and the Bee at the Federal Bar here in LA. And I was super excited to meet him afterwards because I'm a huge fan of his band Geggy Ta. And I posted a picture of me and Greg and said, just talked about Geggy Ta for 10 minutes with Greg Kirsten. I'm super excited. And they're like, oh, that's the Hello guy. And I had no idea that he had produced Hello for Adele. Well, I also had no idea that he did that show taking a break from producing Paul. You know, which, in my opinion, I think that album should just have been Greg, because as much as I could defend Biker Like an Icon, I can't defend Follow You. I love the bridge, but most of that song, I love you, Paul. You know what? I'd rather have any Paul than no Paul. So
what about Get Enough?
Well, Kanye is a sore spot because I'm also a huge King Crimson fan. I did a King Crimson album, Classical Guitar. And, when he did Power with 21st Century Schizoid Man, it caused Robert Fripp to retire for a few years. You know, really? he said he felt raped, you know. Because, he was very mad.
That's very interesting. I've never even considered that. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. But you know, Kanye is an enigma. He's, you know, every generation has those powerful and baffling characters that get, you know, considered a genius. You know, going back to Ramos.
Yes, let's.
My initial detective work into how people feel about it, they either are taking it with open arms or going, why does this exist? You know, best quote was, well, my original copy of Ram sounds fine. Why should I hear anything else? Or, you know, disappointed by the lineup. You know, I'd rather have that than just like indifference, because I feel like the worst thing that could happen to a record is if somebody just ignores it. But it's people have been passionate enough to say either, yes, take my money, or why does this exist? Mm-hmm. And that's part of what makes Kanye Kanye, is that for every five people that think he's the rap genius of the century or the voice of a generation, there's five people that think he's a complete turd, you know? And that's the thing that makes him so huge, is that people love to hate on him as much as they love praising him.
Just to go back to people's reactions to Ramon, I've seen, this is just from, again, my own personal research and looking on Facebook and posts and Reddit and stuff. It's got a great reception than Three Imagined has so far, with all the tracks that Three Imagined has put out. I mean, to have a greater hype around your tribute album than compared to the actual McCartney tribute album that's coming out now, that shouldn't be poo-pooed, you know? You should feel good about it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm thrilled about Three Imagined, too, because, you know, there's some incredible moments on Three, and he's picked some incredible people to do these songs. And I can't, for example, I can't wait to hear the Krangbin track. I think that's going to be mind-blowing. I can't wait to hear the Josh Holm track, because I know that he's going to kill Lavatory Lil. But, you know, it's interesting, because for everyone that says, why reimagine these tracks because they're already perfect, I'll say, look, but Paul's doing it with McCartney 3, you know? So it's interesting that we had a similar idea around the same time.
It's the 50th anniversary. You're not doing it on a frivolous date, you know?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's also the, for everybody that's excited about 3, they're like, oh, he's going to figure out another way for us to buy McCartney 3. Because we've already, you know, the record collectors have already spent hundreds and hundreds of dollars and pounds buying the different colored versions of McCartney 3. And now there's another one.
You should have done that.
We're only going to do one version of Ram On, by the way. We're not going to do multiple colors.
One version which had like Road All Night on it. One version which had Hey Diddle. You know, you really could have stretched it out.
Sunshine Sometime. You know, where I actually thought about doing Road All Night, but you know, there's a certain beauty to that version of Paul and Denny jamming. Mm-hmm. You know that, and also you know that song was finished and given to Roger Daltrey. Yeah. And it's a song called Giddy, which is on his One of the Boys album. And it's not anywhere as cool as Road All Night. So it's kind of better that the lyrics are kind of like indecipherable, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of cool. It's again, Paul is so good at improvising. Mm-hmm. And when you see that song was made up on the spot, man, so good. I mean, it's the same Paul that wrote Freedom in 1 minute, you know, that, you know, there's so many times that Paul's mumbo's, you know, written in a second, you know, but it's so great because that's when you're such a genius that even the stuff that you make up on the spot potentially is life altering. Perfect example. You know, freaking yesterday that he woke up from a dream and wrote Scrambled Eggs, you know, and now it's Yesterday, the most covered song of all time. It's amazing, you know, it's really, really beautiful.
Yeah.
That a human being can be so effortless at what he does. And as a person that's seen Paul play many times, there's the whole topic about him not drinking water at shows.
It's true.
Man, he's 78 years old, singing songs in the original key and playing 39 songs. That's the thing. One of the things that I talked about is how when you go see Paul, every other show becomes almost like you're cheated. When you see a young band play an hour 10, an hour 20, you know,
yeah,
and then call it a day, when someone almost 3 times their age can play for 39 minutes without a break and scream at the top of his lungs, play bass, play guitar, play piano. You know, somebody asked recently, actually, it was a Beatles Facebook post. Like, what did the Beatles do? I forgot what the exact question was, but what did the Beatles do to influence you? Mm. And what I said was they raised the bar so high that we have to reach to the stars to attempt to get to their level. Mm. And there's 2 types of musicians. There's ones that want to be Beatles quality and ones that take the easy way out. And I feel like every musician that's on Ram On are people that are making music inspired by not just the Beatles musically, but the Beatles as human beings and the Beatles as working musicians. Because they work their asses off. I mean, another reason why, you know, the Beatles kind of decided to call it a day after only 7 years of putting out records is that those 7 years were grueling. Even when they went off the road, they spent a lot of time making these records. And it was taxing on them. You know, Ringo quit during White Album. George quit during Let It Be. John quit and they finished Let It Be without him. You know, there was a lot of emotional distress of having to top each record, especially after Rubber Soul, where you see an echo in the canyon, the movie I'm in, where Brian Wilson talks about hearing Rubber Soul and going, this is the greatest thing I've ever heard. How do we top this? And then they made Rubber Soul. Pet Sounds, which then Paul was like, how do we top this? You know, Revolver, Sgt. Pepper, you know. So it's really interesting to see. That's something that doesn't happen a lot anymore in pop music is people challenging other people to be better. When I hear a Ariana Grande song, it doesn't make me want to be better. It kind of like makes me feel sad that I would have to dumb down my art to make it more marketable. You know, nothing against Ariana Grande as a person or even as a singer. It's just that the music is not inspiring to me. When I hear half of the music that won Grammys this year, it doesn't really, you know, I understand why it exists, but are we really pushing forward as musicians, as artists, as creators, when every song kind of sounds the same? You know, I'm Cuban. I'm from Miami, Florida. And there's this thing that's taken over the world called reggaeton music. Mm-hmm. And there's Bad Bunny. There's Karol G. And there's a major artist now. And that's an entire genre based on one beat. There's the old joke about what the Beatles would have sounded like if Pete Best would have stayed on drums. And there's that silly remix of I'm the Walrus with the...
Oh, that's mean. No, that's so...
I know. But he did pretty much play one beat, you know, throughout the entire time. You know, reggaeton is one beat. That's the whole genre, you know. That's the thing that makes it so exciting as a Beatles fan. They listen to the Beatles and have the same band that did She Loves You is the same band that did Side 2 of Abbey Road. The same four musicians, the same producer, the same studio, the same 10 fingers, you know, on each hand, on each arm. Well, 2 to 5 for each hand. If they did have 10 fingers on each hand, that would explain it. The same 10 fingers playing completely different types of music in different levels of complexity, equal amounts of beauty, you know? Sorry, I'm a rambler, but I just love talking.
No. I mean, it fits to do rambling. You know what? I'll try and rein it in. I'll do some professional questions. Sure. So obviously you only live 8 minutes away from Denny Seiwell, but how did you come to meet him? How did the project start, you know?
Well, I first met him at a convention that happens every year pre-COVID called the NAM convention, which is the National Association of Music Merchants. And basically it happens every year in Anaheim, California. And what it is a large convention of musical instrument makers. And they invite all of their artists, and Denny's always there walking around, and I introduce myself, and, you know, we got along from minute one of talking. And then I ran into him again at a Denny Lane show where I was actually asked to sit in with the band, and I got to play the acoustic part on Band on the Run with Denny. Actually, a lot of my friends that are in Bebopalula, the band that did Uncle Albert on Ramon, they play with Denny. Alex Jules, Ben LaCourte, my friend Eric Paparazzi, they all play with Denny. And they invited me to play the acoustic guitar part on Band on the Run. And that night, Denny
CNF,
and his
wife, baby, just CNF.
Yeah, it's simple. But it was just incredible. You know, it was just like another pinch myself moment. So I had gotten Denny's information. I knew I was going to hire him for something. I ended up in a band called Open Sound that was doing a covers record, and we had talked about doing Too Many People, and I said, well, let's take it to the next level and pull some money and hire Denny to play drums, and let's get to do two songs, and I picked Some People Never Know, which is my favorite song on Wildlife. So we did those two songs. He loved my studio, he loved my work ethic, and he loved my playing. Open Sound didn't work out. We did one album and then nothing. And I always told Denny, I'm like, it would be awesome if we did like a Ram band and played Ram live. COVID happened, and then that became an album concept. So I convinced Denny that we could get the original sounds and make a new version of the album for the 50th anniversary. Now, Denny is 78 years old and a responsible adult. So he texted Paul and said, hey, is this cool if we do this? And he wrote back and said, great idea. Have fun.
And that was it. I mean, did you have to pay to like license the music or anything? Or was it?
Well, to release it, we got a license through Harry Fox Organization and through MPL. So it's all worked out. But anybody could cover anything. You know, I've actually, I produced a record for Yes's management the 50th anniversary tribute to Yes that came out back in 2019. I've played on all the other tribute records, and I've put out album covers. I just put out a Todd Rundgren album called TR Guitar, also on Cherry Red, which is all Todd Rundgren songs done instrumental. And anybody could cover a song. You just need to get a license to sell it.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, I mean, it's all worked out. You know, there's no, it's all legally worked out. But here's the exciting thing is that I saw with my own eyes a text from Paul McCartney, because Denny and Paul are really good friends. And he is not a man of, he's not a man of many words on text, but they text often. And it's funny, he started scrolling. He's like, see, look, we talk all the time. And I was just like, I can't believe what I'm seeing. You know, it's like anytime you see a god like McCartney being human, you know, like the paparazzi photos and stuff, it's like it reminds you that we're all made of the same flesh and bone. It's just Paul made better use of it.
I've got this Snapchat filter, you know. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I've got Instagram. Yeah.
That would be hilarious, too, if you got like a IG message or a Snapchat or whatever. I don't know. I also found out that Ringo's an emoji guy.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. Like every text that he has from Ringo is like,
smiley face.
You know, peace and love.
Peace and love. No autographs.
Peace and love. I got to meet Ringo. You know, he's also in Echo in the Canyon. And I got to meet Ringo backstage at the Echo in the Canyon premiere. And my friend Ken Sharp was also on the record. Said, Ringo, this is my friend Fernando. And I have a video of this. He's like, Fernando, what's going on? I'm like, he knows my name. You know, it's like, I still haven't met Paul, but I still wonder about the scientific process that my body's going to go through. Like, shock? Will I become?
Roll with it. Just
will
go.
I overspeak? Will I underspeak? Will I die? You know, will it cancel out? Will I, you know, it's one of those things, because it's like I've only gotten to meet Ringo. I never got to meet John or George. In fact, I was only 3 months old when John died, so I'm only 40, so I missed a lot of the good stuff. Mm. My first concert ever was Ringo and the All-Stars, second tour. The one with McCartney. The one with Burton Cummings, Todd Rundgren, Joe Walsh, Timmy Capello. And talk about a great first concert. I mean, it was like buffet, you know? It's like being hungry and walking into a buffet and, you know, there's all your entire record collection on stage, you know? Timmy B. Schmidt doing I Can't Tell You Why, you know, Joe Walsh doing In the City and Rocky Mountain Way, you know, Burton Cummings. The opening song of the night was No Time Left for You with, you know, Todd Rundgren playing lead guitar. And then, you know, you get Yellow Submarine and Photograph and Don't Come Easy. And if you haven't seen Ringo and the All-Stars, it's never a waste of your money. It's always an incredible time.
That certainly beats me seeing Jamiroquai at the Birmingham NEC. That's
Oh, which tour?
It was for Dynamite.
Wow.
Yeah, Black Devil Car blew down the house that night. Oh, my God.
As long as Stuart Zender was on bass, one of my favorite bass players. I actually, one of my ex-girlfriends got me into Jamiroquai. And you know, in America, they're a one-hit wonder, which is stupid, you know.
Which is their hit?
Virtual Insanity is the only thing that made it out here.
There's so much more.
I know. You know what it is? You see the shirt I have on right here?
Oh,
this is one of my top five favorite bands of all time. And in America, they're a one-hit wonder. In Europe, they're a 15-hit wonder, you know? So it's like, I don't understand. America has this filter where, you know, we don't know about Stone Roses. We don't know about, you know, we don't know about, even Take That didn't make it here. You know, we got Robbie Williams. We didn't get Take That, you know? So it's interesting to see all the stuff that's huge in England, that's huge in Europe, that doesn't filter out here. So Jamiroquai, underrated band. And that first album, Emergency on Planet Earth, is my favorite.
Yeah. It's one of those few space albums that's not too corny. You know, it's like, I'll roll with this.
No, they're fantastic and very underrated. And JK is, you know, a lot of people consider him a Stevie Wonder ripoff. No, man, he's his own thing. I love his vocals. I love his delivery. And I love the interesting keyboards they use too. A lot of really cool sounds. As a producer, I latch on to anything that gives me chills. And I get intense chills listening to them. So nothing to be sad about that your first concert was Jamiroquai.
If you want to be sad,
I know people that their first concert was like, you know, Britney Spears or Spice Girls or, you know, The Wiggles.
Hey, got nothing wrong with The Wiggles. Speaking of producing, how do you produce an album in a pandemic?
Okay, it's very simple. There's this thing called the internet.
Right.
And it was proven that you can't get COVID by email. So we
get COVID by email?
No. you can get computer viruses.
Hey.
I'm not kidding. Denny Seiwell is calling me right now. I'm not going to accept it.
No, you rang him during when I was interviewing him. That's really funny. I think it's just us at the moment, folks. Oh, I think it's going quite well. This is another one of those times where I'm like, oh, gosh, I haven't asked half the questions I want yet, and yet I've got more content than I ever could have imagined, really. My gosh. What am I going to ask?
Denny Seiwell knocked me off the Paul or Nothing.
That's funny.
So I hit the wrong button and I took the call and I'm like, I'm doing the interview. And Denny's like, I'm sorry.
No, but you rang him when I was interviewing him.
Oh, that's right.
Yes.
So, that's funny.
Yeah.
See?
It rhymes, man. It's all poetry, you know?
Okay. So basically you can't get COVID through email. So what we did is we created guide tracks and we started sending files out everywhere. To anyone that I knew was not just a Beatles fan, not just a Paul McCartney fan, but Ram fans.
Right.
I've met a lot of musicians and Ram comes up a lot. And these are musicians that I've had conversations with about Ram. These are musicians that I've jammed songs with. You know, just this guy, Jacob Jeffries, who played piano on Dear Boy, that I have distinct memories of jamming with him. Too Many People, Dear Boy, Backseat in My Car. Back in Miami when we were teens. So it was interesting because, you know, Denny provided a few people, but I provided a lion's share of people that I felt deserved to be on this record. And when people say, well, the lineup doesn't really inspire me. Well, that's the thing is that I've seen a lot of tribute albums crash and burn because they have Flavor of the Month artists that might not have the same approach to covering a song than artists that are in love with the original version would. And everybody that sings a song on this record sings it with passion, with respect, and with joy. There's joy in everything we do. And the only thing, and this is actually the toughest thing about making this record, was Denny said he would only do it if he had final say on who sings what, who plays what. And he said, I'd like to hear multiple singers sing each song and then pick the best one. So some incredibly good and some famous were not picked because Denny picked the ones that his ear perked up to, not based on fame, not based on clout, and not based on friendship. So, for example, I'm not going to say who he beat out, but Adrian Bourgeois, who sings Dear Boy, beat out some named people because he just was the best one. And he's only 26, and he doesn't really have a name for himself yet. But we're hoping that through this record, people are going to check him out and say, I love that voice. I want to hear his stuff. You know, Brentley Gore, who sang Backseat in My Car, he got picked, and I got a phone call from one of my favorite new indie artists that said he wanted to sing Backseat in My Car. And I said, look, Denny's already picked the guy, you know? So what you hear on Ram On is the best possible people on each track as picked by someone who was there when Paul played these songs, which is Denny, because his standards are already through the roof, because he remembers being there behind the drum kit with Paul playing the guitar saying, I've got this new song called Another Day. And he talks about it in these videos that we're putting out, where it's like he looks at Spinoza and goes, oh my God, this is happening. You know, we're the Beatles now. You know, we're his new Beatles, you know. And he's playing these songs to us the same way that he played the songs to John, George, and Ringo and said, I've got this new song. It's called, you know, She's Leaving Home. What should I do with this? I've got this new song. It's called Hey Jude, you know.
Speaking of Dave Spinoza, by the way, did he recreate history and leave halfway through the sessions?
Yes, he had a jingle to do. I think it had something to do with, he had to do some Quaker Oats commercial. Yeah, that's a funny story because, you know, as a working guitar player, I've double booked myself before.
Really?
But
oh, wow.
If Paul called, let's just put it this way. There's a great story that Denny tells, which is heartbreaking because I'm a huge Blood, Sweat, and Tears fan, as I said. And Paul decided to bring in James William Guercio to finish Ram. When they were in London, in L.A., James Guercio came in to produce a couple of songs for Ram, one of them being Dear Boy. And James got the call that Paul McCartney wanted him to come in after he had booked his honeymoon. And he said, it's Paul McCartney. Okay, my honeymoon can wait. So he canceled his honeymoon, went to L.A., and it only took a day and a half for Paul to fire him.
Oh, my God.
And Denny said that one of the most uncomfortable things he's ever seen was Paul firing Jimmy. And Jimmy, okay, I shouldn't say this. Jimmy cried. Imagine you get hired and fired by Jimmy Guercio. By Paul McCartney.
Paul McCartney.
And you canceled your honeymoon. But I would cancel. I would postpone a wedding or for McCartney. I mean, you know, you put everything aside. That's the ultimate phone call.
You're a producer. I'm going to imagine you're Hugh Padgham for a moment, and Paul McCartney looks over to you and says, "You know, you've just made a criticism about a drum track," and then he goes, "Well, did you write Yesterday?" Oh my. You just melt, wouldn't you? What do you say to that? There's nothing you can do.
Well, that's the thing. Paul is why we're here.
Yeah.
Not just because this is a Paul McCartney podcast, but he is that spark that made me want to not just play guitar, but play everything. You know, I got introduced to McCartney when I was about 7 years old, the album McCartney.
Ooh.
And I remember looking at that record and going, Paul played everything. It could be done, you know? And next thing you know, I was asking my mom for a four track for Christmas. And I got that when I was 10, 11 years old. And I was learning the drums and learning the guitar and bass and trying to sing harmonies and stuff. That's where it all started to me. You know, it's like he is the template, you know. Todd Rundgren and Paul are my two biggest templates when it comes to my career. And Paul, you know, set the bar very high. And it's what we all strive for, you know, the excellence, the confidence, the sheer confidence. That's one of Paul's biggest traits, is confidence. You know, even when he's phoning it in on something, it's pure confidence, you know, that he's just a badass at every single thing he does, you know. I love that.
Oh, yeah.
But making this record was a real incredible experience because this is another scientific thing I noticed. It's easier to find someone that's never heard Ram than to find someone that doesn't like Ram. It's one of those things that once you hear it, you massively fall in love with it. Mm-hmm. Because there's so much to love. Number one, the songwriting is strong. Number two, it sounds like $1 million. The sound Paul got on Ram is quintessential 70s. It's a great headphones listen. The drumming is great. The bass playing is great. The guitar playing is great. The piano playing is great. The singing is great. Linda's awesome on it. I mean,
great.
You know, everybody's got personality. The orchestration, everything about it is a masterpiece. So it was hard to create something that can possibly stand up to it using home studio equipment. And some people even recording on their phones, like Marvin Stamm, who cut the trumpet solo on the original Halsey, you know, played it on the new one. I taught him how to record it on his phone. And that's what you hear on the record, an iPhone recording of his trumpet. And it sounds amazing.
No, but see, that's funny because, like, back in 1969, 1970, Paul is lauded for doing quite rough home recording. Then he does Ram, and it's the quote-unquote polished step-up album. And now home recording is so advanced that Paul can do McCartney 3 and you can do Ram on, literally from home. That's incredible, isn't it?
That's an incredible thing because, you know, for years, the most you could get out of a home recording was a demo, you know, 8 tracks. Sometimes, you know, there's some stuff that crept out like Emmett Rhodes and, you know, some of the, some home recordings, like, you know, when rock stars would build studios in their homes and next thing, you know, Prince, you know, and stuff like that. But these days, most of what we're hearing is recorded in home studios, you know, it's a beautiful thing because now the process of making a record, there's no longer that financial wall that you have to cross. Like one of the things that blows my mind is even if you were making a demo, you had to invest over $100 in tape just to make that demo. Mm-hmm. And you would hear all the time about people re-recording, like erasing and re-recording using the same tape. There's a terrible story I heard because I'm a huge fan of Renaissance, the band Renaissance, that they were also on IRS. The police erased a Renaissance master tape and recorded their first album on that Renaissance master tape. And I'm like, that's heartbreaking because knowing IRS, that was probably the master tape for Camera Camera, which is one of my favorite Renaissance records. Mm.
Yeah, but I mean, you've got Billie Eilish now. And like everyone's like, oh, well, she, you know, she's one of these rich girls. And it's like, yeah, but her and her brother aren't using tech that you can't just buy off, you know, the Apple store for under $50 now, you know, it's all there.
I love Billie. And Billie and Phineas are the future. And I guaranteed they're going to collaborate with Paul. Guaranteed.
Ooh.
They might even do a whole record.
Ooh, that's interesting. That's interesting.
Yeah. That'd be cool. That'd be the Billy Shears record. No, but here's the deal. I was fascinated by a video that's on YouTube where they talk about the studio where they recorded Bad Guy and everything. Ooh. It's rudimentary gear. I mean, Logic,
yeah.
A controller, a $800 mic called the Neumann TLM-103, which is my favorite mic.
Okay.
And she recorded the vocals sitting on a cross leg on a bed, you know, in a bedroom. And that's the biggest selling album of 2020 or 19. And it was recorded at home using $100 software, and a $100 mic, and a controller and a guitar. And it's amazing because, you know what? Sometimes what Paul taught us with McCartney and McCartney 2 is – it's not the technology, it's the passion. Because you listen to McCartney. I recently listened to McCartney 1 with my girlfriend on a drive. And it's fascinating to hear that what makes that record different than other 4-track albums is that Paul didn't have a console. Therefore, a lot of the tracks, he didn't do any bouncing. So you hear 4 elements. Mm-hmm. For example, a perfect example is Mama Miss America. You hear drums, channel 1, bass, channel 2, piano, and electric guitar. And halfway through, the piano track switches to acoustic guitar and the piano goes away.
Right.
So you hear 4 elements. So it's 4 tracks, 4 elements. Same thing goes to Hottest Sun. Same thing goes to That Would Be Something. A lot of the homespun track.
What about Krina Krora, though? That seems pretty complex.
Krina Krora. I love that track. I said, Cindy, do you realize that the first Paul McCartney album ends with a drum solo? And she's like, what? And that's all it is.
Yeah.
It's Paul showing off his drum technique and breathing over it, you know. But that track, I think only has, but I think he finished that one at Abbey Road because it has organ, it has the same organ sound as Maybe I'm Amazed. So I think that one was done at Abbey Road. But God, nobody talks about Queen of Karaya. You're good, man.
No, see,
you know,
I actually know about it because it's cool. It's a bit of a meme on my show as to how much I rag on it as a track.
No, oh, I love it.
I don't know. I'm kind of boring at times. I would have been happy with just another cover of like Lucille or something, you know.
But see, that's the thing is that Paul listened to a lot of music, and I can totally tell that he heard like Toad by Cream or like, you know, and he's like, oh, I want to do a track like that, you know. And one of my favorite tracks on Red Rose Speedway is Loop the First Indian on the Moon. And that's totally like Traffic, you know, to me. That's like, it's such a cool track because it's like Paul goes prog.
Well, like, Pink Floyd, you know? We were like in the studio next door, I think, as well. So there's definitely some leak over there, definitely.
Who?
I think Pink Floyd were like in the next studio.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
At Abbey Road.
But they were in three. They were in the baby room.
Just to go back to Ram for a second, it's interesting just how much of McCartney's career was also fed by unused Ram tracks. Like, you've got the stuff that was never even...
Oh, yeah!
Like, you got A Love For You that was worked on up until, like, the late 80s. He was trying to get that release, you know?
Little Woman Love. The one that kills me is freaking Get On The Right Thing. And
Be A Friend as well.
Yeah, I mean, come on. Get On The Right Thing. I always imagined that being a Wings track, and it's interesting to know that Spinoza is on that, you know?
Mm.
It's really cool. It's a great track, you know? Red Rose Speedway is mind-blowing. That record is great, and it's also awesome to see that all the, you know, the original two-disc version, you know, opening up with Night Out and Jazz Street. And wow, what a cool record, you know? What a cool group of guys and girls and making music with no intention of it being commercial. Because that's the thing that's really cool about Wings is that they had the hits, like My Love, and they had the hits, but the albums, especially if you consider that the regular thing now is that you have an album where it's like a collection of 12 singles, mm-hmm. as opposed to an album that challenges you, like Wildlife. That opens up with a jam, goes into bebop, which is like, you know,
the best kind thing of, ever.
It is the best thing ever, but it's not a hit. You know, Love Is Strange, which is an old song, you know, into Wildlife, into, you know, God, Dear Friend, and Tomorrow, and then weird ass stuff. I mean, you know, it's really cool to see variety on records, and Paul always had variety because, you know, London Town, take London Town, where it's like With a Little Luck and freaking Morse Moose the Grey Goose or whatever, you know, it's like
yeah,
what, you know, it's awesome, you know, I love that song, you know, every album, you know, Back to the Egg has hits like, you know, Getting Closer and you know, on the same album, there's something as nuts, absolutely nuts as freaking, you know, Old Siam Sur and stuff like that. That's just like, wow, they're going punk, you know, with Spin It On, you know? So it's really interesting to see all the variety on every record. Perfect example, Wings of the Speed of Sound. Silly Love Songs, which is considered one of the cheesiest, most hit, like, Paul literally is writing a song about how silly it is to write a love song with a disco beat, which I absolutely freaking adore. Mm-hmm. And on the same record, there's something as nuts, just nuts, as Waino Junco and Note That You Never Wrote and, you know, Cook of the House.
Beware My Love, you know.
Beware My Love, which, by the way, and I love Joe English and I love John Bonham. And it blows my mind that John Bonham got beat up by Joe English. And he sure did. Because as much as I love John Bonham, Joe is the man on that track. Especially live. When they go to, Beware My Love. The weird well, he would be left-hand ride. And the man, he's just does some crazy stuff on that. I love that. And you know, it's like Denny, my God, Denny Seiwell. Paul had great taste in drummers, and every single one of them, from the history of Paul, going all the way to Blair Cunningham, and
I've just discovered Blair. I've literally the podcast is chronological, and
yeah,
I've just started looking at Off the Ground and the Up Close gig and stuff like that. Blair's fucking incredible. Oh my
God. Blair's the man.
Oh my God.
Blair's the man. But you know, he came from the Pretenders. And you know, there's nothing, I have nothing against the previous guy. What was his name? Chris Whitten. But Chris Whitten was more of a session guy, you know, Dire Straits. Mm-hmm. Very like he liked electronics and he played very straight. Blair Cunningham was unique. And one of the things that blows my mind about Off the Ground is that he uses brushes a lot, like on, you know, Hope of Deliverance and even Biker Like an Icon. It's brushes, you know, it's an electric song with brushes on drums with a rides overdub, which I love. It's so cool. There's so many things about Off the Ground. You know, that was the first, I think that was the first CD I bought with my own money. I bought it the day it came out.
That's cool.
93. And, oh, my God. Come on, people. You know, God, what a song. You know.
I'm thinking side two's a little weaker compared to side one at the moment.
It is. Well, you know, it's Peace in the Neighborhood. And, you know, one of the interesting things that we all talk about is reordering records to make them better. That album could have used a little bit of a better order. I think it definitely does kind of, it's not the songs, it's the order that kind of, it starts off very strong.
You want to put on like Big Boys Bickering or Long.
Yeah, Big Boys Bickering would have been great.
Yeah.
Golden Earth Girl, you know, there's some good stuff. I remember the Hope of Deliverance single was very strong. The CD single, you know, and Hope of Deliverance is an incredible song. I love that song. There's some great moments on that record that people don't talk about.
Cosmically Conscious is so good. No one talks about that song.
Cosmically Conscious is incredible. You know, I think he wrote that with the Beatles. Yeah, he wrote that back in the 60s.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, the song that kind of throws the album awry for me is Do You Know What I Mean?
Yeah.
You know, especially because he used to play that second at every show. And it's like he would open up with like Drive My Car. And then go straight into like preachy about, you know, like the cat with the machine in his brain, you know, put it in your own brain. And it's just like, it's okay. It's great. It's a good rocker.
It's funny that song because it's even Linda's White Coated Man's actually a better animal rights protest song. And that's saying something, you know what I mean?
I know, look, you know, Paul was passionate about it and passionate about landmines, passionate about so many different things over the last few years. And that's what makes him human, is that he can stumble.
About Spotify, you know?
Yeah. Look, he can stumble, but he always backs it up with something truly genius, you know? And it's fine. You know, that's the thing. Paul isn't perfect. None of the Beatles were perfect. That's the problem with a lot of the music these days, is that they try to be perfect every song. Mm-hmm. And it's okay to stumble. You know, part of what makes the next song better is if the song previous to it is not that great. You know, I remember listening to Wildlife for the first time and being underwhelmed a little bit by Mumbo and Big Bop as songs. But I can't listen to it any different without hearing those songs be palate cleansers to what's coming later. Because I feel like they have their own joy to them. You know, and from talking to Denny, the goal with Mumbo being the opening track on Wildlife is to really establish that this is not Paul and other musicians. This is a band.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the band playing live on the floor of Studio 2. Take It, Tony was because Paul telling Tony, the engineer, to hit record.
Yeah.
Because he's like, this is never going to happen again. And it's awesome. It's Paul at his most unhinged.
You know what, Fernando? You've already given me an hour of your time. Are you pressed, dude? Are you all
good? No, I'm good.
You good? Awesome.
Let's talk about the album.
Yeah. Well, actually, we've just spoken about Wildlife and Red Rose. I mean, in less than a year, we've got the Wildlife 50th anniversary. You're in touch with Denny Seiwell, dude. Come on.
Got Some People Never Know. It's just a matter of getting him in for a couple of days and doing the drums for the rest of the songs and starting the process again. Denny is being a little apprehensive about it because he's like, you know, Ram is an album that everybody loves. Wings Wildlife is an album that the diehards love and a lot of people kind of dismiss. But that's more reason for us to give it another life because, my God, there's some people on this record that would really shine singing songs on Wildlife. And there's some magic on there. Even Love is Strange, you know, okay, Paul didn't write it, but there's something magical about that. And there's so many great tracks that were recorded during those sessions that can be included. Like, you know, I mean, there's some really good stuff. God, man, that record is special to me. You know, my old band Dreaming in Stereo used to do Wildlife. My old band Transcendence used to do Tomorrow. You know, those songs are a part of my history as well.
When you did Wildlife, did you add the coda at the end that they did live?
We did a very interesting version that was very guitar heavy. Like the opening riff, instead of playing the thing on piano, the vibe was like.
Yes.
The vibe. It was like super slow. It was almost like, what would the song sound like if it was played at Woodstock? Like super slow, a little too much marijuana, a little too much booze. And it was just like, we took the key down and it was just like, you know, I took a walk. An African park. The animals have the right of way. Wildlife, whatever happened to wildlife? The animals in the zoo. That's the vibe.
That was like, what if Gary Moore did Wildlife? That was
yes. Gary Moore, Tommy Bolin, Jeff Beck, maybe like BBA, like Beck Booker Peace version.
I was also getting a bit of Matt Bellamy vibes as well from Muse. I got a bit of a Muse vibe there as well.
I love him. I love him. I love all music, but you know, it's like, it's interesting to take these songs and give it a different vibe, and that'll be fun to do. We're going to do it. It's going to be fun. It's going to be great.
Oh, no, look, if you need some atonal backing vocals for Linda, I'm your guy, you know?
That's the thing about this record that was fun is that we got a lot of people, a lot of variety of people. There's a 10-year-old girl singing some backup vocals. She's the daughter of Morty Coyle and Jody Sweden of Full House. And Morty and his daughter, Bia, who is named after the Beatles, her name is Beatrix. named after the Beatles. She sang some BVs on the record, all the way up to Marvin, who's like Marvin Stamm, who's like 83, 84. So there's a lot of variety on the record. And there's, you know, 20s, 40s, 30s, 50s, you know, teenagers. It's really cool that we were able to find every generation of Ram fan. And hopefully we'll create more generations of Ram fans, you know. But yeah, we would love to do Wildlife. That'll be a lot of fun. A lot of ideas that would pop into our heads. But, you know, when it came to making this record, I talked to a few people and they're like, well, are you going to redo them all weird? You know, like, because there was another tribute to Ram that was done called Ram on LA.
2011, yeah.
And there's some interesting stuff on there. There's some songs that were completely changed. Like, I think Eat at Home is like a ballad, or I forgot what it was. They did some weird stuff. And we kind of kept it similar because Denny played the drum parts exactly the same. Mm-hmm. So there's only so much that you could do. There's only one song where he really played differently, which was on Three Legs, where he went for more of a traditional kit as opposed to on the record where he taped up cymbals and did a bunch of stuff. So we went a little more traditional on that one. Also on Dear Boy, he did just one drum kit part as opposed to doing all the parts separate, like on the original. So it's a little funkier, not necessarily. It's a little more of a beat than a part, you know, because on the original, it's very, you know, it's very like Beach Boys type Hal Blaine. And Denny kind of brought it into his old world, the way he's been playing it. But so we started off with Denny playing all the original drum parts, and then we kind of took some liberties. I had some ideas to have female singers, which worked, but Denny was like, I don't know how people are gonna embrace having a female voice on songs that they hear originally from a male perspective. But it ended up working for Oh Woman, Oh Why, because for the first time ever, it's now a dialogue between a woman and a man. So instead of just getting the guy's side of why his girlfriend shot him, now we get the girlfriend's side, you know, tire your cheating ways, you know, die. So it's actually very sexy to me to hear that song with Eric Dover and Lauren Lee now in a dialogue. Another idea I had was to have another day from the girl's perspective, you know, every day I, as opposed to every day she, you know, so sad. Sometimes I feel so sad, but that could be something that could come out in the future. But Gordon Michaels did an incredible job on that song. That's an interesting story. So Gordon Michaels put out an album called Stargazer that was produced by Hugh McCracken. And, there's a song on that record called Indoor Lovers that sounds like Another Day that was in the same key. And that's how he auditioned for the track. Cause I was like, this guy could knock it out of the park. And he did. And he did an incredible job. And he kind of is representing Hugh McCracken because we lost Hugh. So every living musician on the record, aside from Paul, is on the record. Cause we've got Dave Spinoza, Denny Seiwell, Marvin Stamm. Hugh McCracken would have been on it because he was friends with Denny, but we lost him. And Linda's obviously passed away. And, you know, so it's a cool thing to have these names that we've read our entire lives off liner notes, you know. And Dave was great. I mean, he's proud of the record, you know, and he's not ashamed at all of, like, the whole, like, where he only did half the record. He's very proud of what he did, you know. It's great stuff. He's a great player, you know. But as a guitar player, Ram is such a great record. I mean, that Too Many People, that's some of the most electrifying guitar playing I've ever heard on a record. And it's Paul, you know. I love it. It was my audition to get Denny to work with me was to show him how passionately I could play Too Many People. It's a great solo. It's incredible.
I can remember hearing it the first time at university with the help of certain herbal imbibements, shall we say, and because my dad had given me Wings Greatest and Band on the Run, and I was like, you know what, I will try this McCartney guy out, see what he's got, and I got Ram and the McCartney album, and it just blows you away, and then you've got got cowbell in it as well, which really sends off the end for me. Just ways to go dunk, dunk, dunk.
I know. The cowbell part, I insisted on playing because I play it exactly like the record. And it's just like, it's such a great part. I mean, it's so 70s. But when you hear that, it's such a great part. And it's so, there's so much to that track. There's so many layers. And, man. And, you know, the secret weapon of that album, that thing, you know, is this thing called it's called a micro vibe. It's actually a univibe. And that's the sound. It's actually up a capo. And it's that sound, and I think Hugh had it because I hear on recordings that it's all over the tracks of Hugh, and it's kind of like the Jimi Hendrix, you know. It's the like Band of Gypsies sound, but it's all over. I mean, everything, all the tracks on you know. My God, it's all over. I mean, it's such a cool thing. Yeah, I mean, it's also all over, like, you know, Dark Side of the Moon. But I mean, from a guitar point, that record is so influential on all of us. And it's just like, it's also a great record when it comes to the orchestration of all the parts. Everything on that record is there for a reason. Mm. Going from the, you know, it's like, it's an interesting Paul record. I don't think they had a lot of keyboards at A&R because I don't hear a lot of organ. I hear a lot of piano. Mm. I hear some Fender Rhodes, and I hear, there's no synths on, there's no real synthesizers on RAM. So it's a very interesting record because one of the things that's made RAM stand the test of time is that there's nothing on that record that pigeonholes it as a 70s record. There's no weird synthesizer, you know, there's no, like, nothing on that record gives it the early death of it being a product of its time. It's mm-hmm. timeless. There's that video that's been going around about the whole, like, you know, that this was the first indie rock record. Mm-hmm. And in many ways, it was, because there's so much variety to the material. I mean, what record starts off with something as powerful as Too Many People and then goes into Three Legs, which is a bluesy porch song, you know, to me, and then goes into Ram On, the first ever ukulele song, you know. The ukulele was a novelty instrument. It's Tiny Tim, Tiptoe Through the Tulips, you know. Ram On was proof that you could play a ukulele and it be emotional, because there's a beauty to Ram On, you know. The ukulele almost adds to a certain, you know, there's the old joke that you can't be sad on a banjo or a ukulele, but you can, because Ram On to me is one of the more emotional songs that Paul's written. It's beautiful.
Yeah, I mean, if you go to the concert for George, I'll See You in My Dreams.
Yeah.
The song that ends it, that's the saddest song ever, and that's ukulele, isn't it?
It's beautiful. Oh, God, the concert for George. Talk about a perfect thing. I mean, that's a perfect send-off, you know.
Oh, it's one of the best recorded, like, DVD concert films you can watch ever. Yeah.
It is. It makes me sad, though, because, you know, sadly, it's going to happen to Paul and Ringo eventually, you know. But what's it going to be like?
Well, Paul's is going to have, you're going to have Dave Grohl there.
Oh, God.
basically everyone I've three imagined. I want Kanye and Rihanna doing 4 or 5 seconds.
You're making it sound like it's going to happen in the next 5 years. No. In 30 years, when he's 112, who's going to be on it? All the people that were on McCartney 5, of course. You know, that's the old joke.
It's like, you're going to produce it, you know? Come on.
You're, you know, look, your lips to God. I would love to work with Paul. I know the songs. I have a massive admiration for him. And I also kind of understand where he's coming from, you know, but he's got great guys around. I mean, the current band is phenomenal. Brian Ray and man, I mean, you know, those guys are incredible. I've actually had interesting run-ins with people. I'm from Miami, Florida. And my band used to play shows with Gabe Dixon Band. And when I found out that Gabe Dixon was playing keys with Paul on Driving Rain and at the concert for New York, I was thrilled. And then when I found out that he told Paul no and quit the band before the tour, I mean, but I understand. His band had just gotten signed.
Right. That makes sense.
So he chose Gabe Dixon over Paul McCartney. But damn. You know, which forever changed Wicks's life again, because he's the only holdover from Flowers in the Dirt off the ground to now. And Wicks is great. He's awesome. He's a big part of every Paul show. But yeah. And then my old band, I was in a band called Price that was signed to Geffen, and they made a demo without Abel Boreal producing. But I wasn't in the band anymore. But I did a rehearsal with Abe. And Abe was great. And I asked him a bunch of great questions. I was just like, I said, you don't look like a vegetarian. And he's like, I was for a while, but you know, it's interesting. The whole all veggie thing for a while, like, but still I love Paul. I'd love to work with him, but
come on, Fernando. If Paul comes up to you and says, look, Fernando, I loved Outer Sea 1, 2, and 3, come and do my next album. Would you take the gig, or would that be too daunting?
I'm not an idiot. You know, I would take the gig if, you know, somebody asked a good question, because, you know, I'm very vocal about my issues with Kanye. And they're like, if Kanye asked to play for you to play on a record,
yes.
I mean, I'm an idiot to say no.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I'm not going to be as excited. As a professional musician that has to feed a family, yes, I would do it. But for God's sakes, you know, Paul is one of those situations that if he calls, you drop everything, you know. And he's heard this. From what I understand, he's heard this and he loves it. So fingers crossed.
Come on. I mean, Idris Elba did one interview with him on the BBC and then he ends up on Three Imagined. Come on. You know, you are 6 degrees from Kevin Bacon. Just make some calls. Just pop into the Capitol building. Drop off some muffins. You know,
I produced a session at the Capitol building, and that was I thought that was pretty pinnacle. But you know, I made a record called Zebra Crossing at Abbey Road, and that was mind numbing. I played
sit in Abbey Road Studio 2 and sit at the piano. Studio 2.
Now, here's the crazy part: is I booked the time. This was September 2018, and I booked the time, and Paul did the unveiling of Egypt Station there on a Monday. I went there on a Wednesday, and he played the Mrs. Mills piano at that show on that Monday, and I played it on Wednesday. So his DNA got in my fingers. Yeah. I could have cloned him based on, you know, if I would have taken a sample off the keys. But yeah, it was incredible to sit there in that room and make my own music. And there's a version on YouTube of us doing While My Guitar Gently Weeps, because I'm a big fan of the album, the Beatles recording sessions. And when I booked when I booked the date of that thing, I looked up all the different dates of that date in, you know, on that thing. And I found out that the date that I was recording there was the 50th anniversary of when they first did that version of While My Guitar Gently Weeps Is Just Guitar and Organ from the anthology.
Yeah.
The first time that George sang that song at Abbey Road. So
that's so crazy because
it's July 25th, 1968, and my session was July 25th, 2018. And we did While My Guitar Gently Weeps with Diane Birch, with just like, it was a really, really cool process to record the song with Sean Lee, Jason Rowe, aka Jai, Paul Stacey, Dave Bainbridge, Andy Mapp. It was an incredible process, Daphne Rowe. And singing that song 50 years after George came in and said, I've got this song, you know, played it there for George and Paul. Paul played some harmonium on it. And
it's so funny because I got into the Beatles first through my dad's original iPod, and he just illegally downloaded so much of this music. And back on LimeWire, if you remember LimeWire back in the day, and he didn't know the back catalogue, so he just downloaded whatever. And for about 10 years, I thought that anthology version of While My Guitar Gently Weeps was the actual version. That was and to me,
I have a funny story about the White Album. My older brother got it on CD, and I begged him to make me a cassette of it, and he only taped disc one. I was in love with it, but at the same time, I was just like always wondering what disc two was like. And I finally got it, and I was just like, oh, okay, this is where some of the meat. Because still, for this day, when I talk about, my God, White Album is such a great album, and I actually enjoy it as a double album, you know? It doesn't really bother me that, you know, it has filler, but it's fantastic. I love that record. But the thing that kills me about that record is, you know, the variety. Again, talk about variety, you know, where on the same record you have something as hit-like as, you know, Obla-Di-Bla-Da and Back in the USSR. And on the same record is Revolution 9, Long, 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 you know, Your Blues. Everyone's Got Something to Hide Except Me and My Monkey. You know, there's so much variety on that record. These days you get a record from a band and it always seems like the same style all the way through. I think we need to have more variety on records, you know? Yeah, there should be, if you have a Obla-Di-Bla-Da, you need to have a Savoy Truffle, you know? If you have a Back in the USSR, you have to have an Everybody's Got Something to Hide Except for Me and My Monkey. It should be mandatory.
Or at least people's subsequent albums should start having that stuff. Like, you know, if you've got to make The Fame Monster, you know, make that your Please Please Me, then, like, Chromatica should be a little bit more interesting by this point, you know. And I'm a self-confessed Lady Gaga fan, but it's not been a trajectory upwards. It's been a trajectory middling, you know. There's not that same story. A good example would be someone like St. Vincent. Every album's different. Album's been a massive progression since the last one. And you can go, oh, this is the album where she learned how to use horns. This is the album where she got synth down. And you can, you know, you can do a little flow chart with it. And you can do that with the Beatles.
Yeah. There's a little bit of everything. And that's the thing, is that they were a product of their own curiosity. Because perfect example is George. You know, he saw those instruments while making Help in the Indian restaurant scene and said, I should get into the sitar. And he took it to the next level where it became almost an equal voice to his guitar. And, you know, nobody does that anymore.
When it says you're playing Rain, is that that thing that you just turn upside down?
No. I put a microphone out and actually recorded the Rainfall. That's why I'm credited as Rain on that. And then he's credited, and it means credited on Thunder because he recorded Thunder. So,
I'm sure.
Fun stuff.
Additional ukulele, got you there, electric guitars, Mellotron percussion.
But no, you know, like to George discovering Indian music and taking it full on, you know, Paul's interest in so many different styles and genres of music. And, you know, he was fully aware of all the creative bands. Proof positive is when, you know, recently in the Sparks documentary, it's talking about how Paul dressed up as Ron Mael, you know.
The coming up video.
Yeah.
Which is a weird little connection. Oh, actually, you just reminded me of something there. Behind me, folks, you can obviously see the artwork for the album. Yeah. And I love the artwork for your three solo albums with that guitar that's a boat.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's interesting because that's actually painted by Genesis's original artist, Paul Whitehead, who did three other albums, three other classic albums, Trespass, Nursery Crime, and Foxtrot. So that's actually original paintings by Paul from a series he did. And it's, you know, it's beautiful paintings for the guitar boats, and I love it, you know. And it perfectly matches the music, because if you hear those records, it's very nautical-themed instrumental prog, you know.
Well, it's got a nice visual pun that I like, and so does this cover, because it literally is Ram. Yes. Without Paul McCartney on it. Like, it, yes. It totally makes sense.
Well, that is my brilliant girlfriend, Cindy Trissel, who we were trying to come up with something that will give the spirit of Ram without ripping it off. Because all the other Ram tribute albums have used the sides and the basically, like Dave Depper's Ram project, it's him and a cat, you know? And like they all use the side and stuff, and we wanted it to be our own thing.
And you've used the inside. Well, actually, I don't think it'll actually appear on this feed, but you've used the inside color scheme, the blue and green.
We wanted it to have the feel of Ram without it being a ripoff of it, you know. And we're not looking to replace Ram. We're looking for it to be, for this record to be a companion piece. So that you've enjoyed Ram for all your life a certain way. Here's some different generations with the original drummer and guitar player, you know, playing these songs and bringing new life to them. You know, it's a beautiful thing. We really did it with respect. And Denny would not have let this happen if it wasn't to his standards. And his standards are very high. And very happy with how it turned out. And I hope people dig it, you know.
One of my favorite things to do right now is to buy an album and then buy the CD and slip the CD into the separate vinyl case and have a nice little complete collection. I've got the half speed of Ram that's just been announced. That's on the way. And Ram On, the 50th anniversary to Paul and Linda McCartney's Ram, is going to go right in there. It's going to be
yay! Well, here's the thing is that the thing that blows my mind is that, you know, this music is timeless, and it really is going to fascinate people that we were able to take this music and create a tasteful replication with its own vibe. And every singer brings their own personality, every guitar player brings their own personality, every bass player, every keyboard player, everything. So it's the same music presented tastefully with a new feel. And it's also, as a fan, like I, every record I produce, I look at it inside and out and say, how would I feel if I saw an email saying that this album existed? And I would be very, you know, curious to hear Denny at 78 playing the same parts with all these new different people on it. And I would dig it. I think I would be very excited that it's not a bizarre redo. It is done with love for the original record. And you could tell that we're not just paying tribute to the songs. We're not just paying tribute to Paul. We're not just paying tribute to even Ram as an entity. We're paying tribute to the production, the playing, the artwork, the spirit of the lyrics, the stories, we're paying tribute to every little element that makes the album, because we're all producers, we're all, you know, multi-instrumentalists, we're all songwriters, and this album has influenced every fiber of our being, from our choices and, you know, when we sequence our albums, to album covers, to our choices in guitars and guitar effects, and our choices in songwriting. You know, this album, the thing that I hear the most about Ram is that it is influential to the fiber of our being as musicians. Because this is an album that most of us discovered early that set the bar very high as a statement. The album is a statement. And, it, you know, the critics didn't like it. Even the Beatles didn't like it. I mean, there's famous stories about Ringo and John being baffled by it, you know. But it's a perfect album.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of albums that you could say are perfect. And every song on Ram is perfect as together, you know. Some songs, you know, you pull out and you're like, okay, Three Legs seems a little, you know, simple, but there's a purpose for Three Legs. It's a palate cleanser between too many people that just blew your face off, so that it prepares you for some softer tunes like Ram on, Dear Boy, and Uncle Albert. You know, if you followed too many people with Ram on, it would be too jarring.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Three Legs is a perfect middle ground between Too Many People and Ram On. And that's why the album is done in sequence. It was my insistence to include Another Day and Omen of Why.
Mm-hmm.
We would have gone whole hog if we would have had a little more time and done, you know, the other tunes that were done on the record. Like, I would have loved to have done Little Woman Love as a funk tune. You know, I had some ideas for that. Sunshine Sometime, I love that song. I mean, it'll be beautiful to do that one
with the vocals as well. I've only just I didn't even know there was vocals for it. It blew me away. Oh my god,
a beautiful song, great bass line too, great song, just the whole the progression, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, of course I grab a guitar, this is an opportunity.
I believe you can play it. I believe.
No, yeah, but it's so good, you know.
How many people can just pull out a guitar and just play Sunshine Sometime off the top?
Why not?
Folks,
why not?
That's the best thing. Oh my god, that's amazing.
Why not?
Do Water Spout right now.
The Water Spout, I wish. You got me. You know what? But I'm not one of those people that could play any song at any time. But that song just made me want to learn it immediately.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, look, man. I love all the weird tunes, you know.
Walk it up.
That stuff kills me.
So
that stuff kills me. You know, I love that stuff. I mean, look, man. This is the beginning of my life when it came to music, was obsessing over Paul, Wings, that whole thing. There was a pivotal moment that happened that I just remembered. When Jeff Emmerich put out the very controversial book, Here, There, and Everywhere, mm-hmm. he did a talk in Miami. And I went to the book signing event, and he talked only about the Beatles, and he said he opened the room to questions. And I said, well, you know, these Beatles stories are great, but I'd love to hear more about, you know, you being brought in to work on Band on the Run. And if you have any wing stories, he says, why would anybody want to hear about that? I honestly don't remember. And people looked at me like, who is this freak talking about wings at a Beatles thing? And my friend Dan Warner, who was the guitar player for Barry Gibb and for Gloria Estefan, he came up to me afterwards and he said, never stop being you, because you're the only you in this world. And I always let that be with me. And this is exactly who I am. I'm the weirdo that decided to do a new version of Ram with Denny Seiwell. I'm the weirdo that just made an album with Karma and a Piece because I'm obsessed with BBA and Cactus and Vanilla Fudge. You know, I mean, I'm the weirdo that's produced a Yes cover by Curved Air. You know, it's like, I'm a weird record collector that loves the stuff that affects me is not necessarily what affects the people around me. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm trying to work with Judy Zook, you know, who was one of my favorite artists of all time. I've been trying to contact David Clayton Thomas. You know, I actually, when I was on tour in Sweden, I recorded a song at the Cardigan Studio, at Tambourine Studios. Look, man, you know, I have bizarre tastes in music, but I take it to the next level because, you know, I still love these people that are still alive, that are still creative, making music. That's all that matters, man.
On that note, I can't think of a better way to end the conversation than on that very eloquent, erudite note.
Yeah.
Dude, when's the album coming out and where can people find it?
It's coming out 50 years to the day of the release of Ram, May 14th, 2021. And it comes out on Cherry Red, Spirit of Unicorn, which is the label that's run by Yes's management on Cherry Red. And it'll be available everywhere in stores, online, digital. And we're hoping to have vinyl for Christmas. But for now, it's the only. I kind of told him, I'm like, if this album sells well enough, we're going to have to do vinyl. So we'll do a separate vinyl order. But for now, it's CD and digital. And it'll be out on May 14th. And you can pre-order it now through anywhere. Amazon, Rough Trade, anywhere.
Yeah, I'll have three vinyls when they're ready, please. I'll have one signed by you, one signed by Denny, and one by Dave Spinoza, I think.
Yay! Awesome.
And you can charge $50 each for the signatures as well.
I have a question for you. From what you've heard, what's your favorite track?
Oh, it was probably "Oh Woman, Oh Why" because it really caught me off guard with that vocal.
Are you a Jellyfish fan?
My musical knowledge is deep, but very, very narrow. I know about three.
Okay, so Eric Dover, who's the male voice on that, was the guitar player for Jellyfish after the Spilt Milk album. And he was also the singer in Slash's Snake Pit.
Okay.
Yeah, but he's got the Steven Tyler vibe on this, and it's just amazing. And Lauren Lee, I produced her album. She's a soul singer from San Diego, who's in her 20s, and she's just incredible. But "Oh Woman, Oh Why" is one of those tracks that when I first bought Ram, it was a bonus track. And it's just like, oh my God, that song just blows my mind. That drum intro from, you know, as a guitar player, there's just something sexy about that song. I mean, you know, just, you know what it is? It's the space between the riffs. It's just like, I can't even sing that high. I just realized something. "Oh Woman, Oh Why" influenced more than a feeling.
Oh,
check it out.
Yeah. What's up? My best friend's a huge Boston fan. This is driving mad.
So Tom Scholz probably listened to Oh Man Oh Why and said. That's literally the guitar part during that section. And then he just changed it to D. So Tom Scholz needs to call Paul and said, I got that from you.
Oh, not another lawsuit, not another
No lawsuit. There's two types of things that could come of this. Either a lawsuit or a hug. And I think they should just hug it out.
Awesome.
I think hugs are going to become the new drug. You know, now that like COVID is going to be gone soon, everyone's going to be hugging each other like, you know, like brothels in the 70s, you know, hugging is going to be
thing. Dude, like I've had a couple of months off furlough. I work in a classic British pub. I go back to work next week.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Oh, it's going to be a fucking nightmare. It's going to be a nightmare. I'm like, oh, no,
it's going to be everything you want it to be.
Well, I'm just at home chatting to LA record producers instead.
This has been a blast, Sam. You're the man.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I will make sure all the links are down below for your socials and for like the links to the album.
Awesome. I hope everybody, you know what? Here's what I want. I want everybody that listens to this record to tell us what you think about it. And even if it's negative, I honestly would rather have everybody talking about it than indifference, because that's the key thing here. It's about people talking about Ram. Our goal is for it to up the amount of people talking about Ram. And if you don't like it, listen to the original, damn it. You know,
and you know,
as long as everybody's listening to Ram, it's going to be a perfect world, right?
Oh yeah. And you know, you'll probably have some super, you know, diehard fans saying, oh, it's not as good as the King Crimson cover album, you know.
Well,
nah,
I even could disagree, because I love my King Crimson tribute album, but it's just a classical guitar record. This record was like, it took every inch of my being to like create this record and do it the right way. It was a hard one. And a lot of credit goes to our mixing engineer, Zach Ziskin, to be able to... He's also a huge Ram fan, and he didn't have to listen to Ram to make it sound right. He knew what it sounded. And it's there. It's definitely there. So, good times, man. What a pleasure. I can't think of a better way to spend my afternoon.
Thank you. You've given me about double the time I thought I was going to get off you, so you've been very gracious. Thank you so much. Peace and love. No more autographs.
Peace and love. No interviews. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you.